This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Welcome to Grand Rounds. Today's speaker is Dr. Wilbert Mason, who is Professor Emeritus of Clinical Pediatrics at the Keck School of Medicine, University of Southern California, and an attending physician in the Kawasaki Clinic at Children's Hospital, Los Angeles. Dr. Mason received his MD from the University of California, Irvine, and his master's degree in public health and epidemiology from UCLA. He completed his residency and fellowship trainings at Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. Dr. Mason's research focus has been in Kawasaki disease and more recently the implementation of evidence-based medicine through the use of clinical practice guidelines in the hospital setting. He has also been active in the study and promotion of medical safety in pediatrics. He is the past president of Chapter 2, District 9 of the American Academy of Pediatrics. He represents the AAP in the California Immunization Coalition, serves on its executive board advocacy committee, and co-chairs the Emerging Issues Committee. If you see, he has won multiple awards. The ones that I would like to quote here are the Distinguished Service Award from the Children's Hospital of Los Angeles and the Philip Rothman Memorial Award for Outstanding Teaching. And in from 2001 to 11, he's been the Castle Connolly top doctor. He has authored 56 peer-reviewed publications, 32 book chapters and invited articles, and has participated in a variety of symposia and invited lectures. So the title of his talk today is Kawasaki Disease Update. It's getting curiouser and curiouser. Dr. Mason.
Thank you very much, and I have to have a shout out to my homies at Cedars. We have a lot of friends over at Cedars, and I'll be calling Debbie Lehman later about something else. There's two people on this talk, as you can see, and you can see that I am not Japanese, so Mike Takahashi retired a few months ago, and he escaped. Well, I retired too, but I haven't escaped yet, unfortunately. He is now up at Seattle Children's Hospital. For those of you who know Mike, and I'm sure many of you have met him, you know he is the Energizer Bunny. And within a month of going up there, he was starting a Kawasaki clinic at Seattle Children's. So I think his retirement is the announcement is probably premature. I'd like to talk about Kawasaki today a little different from what I've talked about before. Not quite so much clinical, which is why I offered you the handout from the from American Heart Association, which describes and gives you pictures of Kawasaki disease. I'm trusting that most of us have seen at least one case and can recognize it now, although I must say we're seeing some missed cases now. But there has been a burgeoning of new information over the last 5 years or so. And this is a picture of the Golden Temple in Kyoto, Japan. Any of you who have ever been there, I really recommend going there if you haven't. It's a beautiful temple, probably the most beautiful of all the temples in Kyoto. And we're going to talk about many of the things that emerged when we attended the 10th International Symposium on Kawasaki Disease there in 2012. I have no financial relationships, unfortunately, but I am willing to engage in some. I will talk about some unapproved commercial products, as any talk in pediatrics is bound to, and I do drive a Prius. I think this is a very appropriate slide. You know, Winston Churchill, in speaking about the Soviet Union, said it's a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. And I think even with the burgeoning information that we've had in the last 5 years or so, Kawasaki remains an enigma. And this is Dr. Kawasaki, who is celebrating his 50th wedding anniversary at the symposium when we were there. Very brief history of Kawasaki disease. It was first seen in 61 by Dr. Tomasaku Kawasaki, and he acquired 50 cases subsequently and published them in 1967. Interestingly, it was very controversial. For the first 3 or 4 years, people didn't really think this was a entity. And it wasn't until children started dropping dead due to what they found out was myocardial infarctions did they really take it seriously. And it took a lot of promotion and a lot of teaching by Dr. Kawasaki to really tell people what the importance of this is. In terms of our own Dr. Ben Landing in 1975, who was head of pathology, was the first to show that infantile periarteritis nodosa, which was a very, very rare, thought to be rheumatologic disease at the time, was identical pathologically to what was being described as Kawasaki disease in Japan. The first U.S. cases were published by Marion Mellish in the United States, and the first cases reported in California were by Dr. Ricky Robinson and Bob Adler, who remain affiliated with Children's Hospital. Echocardiograms became available in the late 70s and early 80s, which kind of revolutionized our ability to diagnose it. And finally, we had a treatment in 1983 with the emergence of IVIG. We'll talk a bit about the etiologic theories, and as you can see, there have been many over the years, none of which have proven to be true. Very, very frustrating to an infectious disease person, because we still feel that infectious diseases are involved in this illness. There have been several new diseases not previously thought to exist, described in the late 20th century, Lyme, Legionnaires, AIDS. Everything except Kawasaki has an etiologic agent, and I hope I live long enough to see that agent be described, and we'll touch on that a little bit in the talk. And so I think the words of Alice in Wonderland, as she fell down the rabbit hole, saying it was getting curiouser and curiouser, is an apt description of Kawasaki disease, because the more we know, the more questions there are around what's causing it and how we can best treat it. This is the 10th International Symposium, and much of what I'll be talking to you today about was presented and then subsequently published following that meeting. And it was a very stimulating and interesting and exciting meeting. These are the diagnostic criteria as described by Dr. Kawasaki back in 1967. Fever for 5 days or more, changes of the peripheral extremities, polymorphous exanthem, bilateral conjunctival injection without exudate. It's not a purulent conjunctivitis. It is alleged to be associated with limbic sparing. Don't hang your hat on that, because there's a lot of kids I've seen that you can't, the inflammation is so intense you really can't tell if there's limbic sparing. So I just am waiting for the day that some kid comes in with Floyd Kawasaki disease and doesn't get treated because he didn't have limbic sparing. Changes of the lips and oral cavity, and the least common of the classic criteria, acute non-purulent cervical lymphadenopathy measuring greater than 1.5 centimeters. So the diagnostic criteria called for having fever, and four of the five other criteria that allowed you to make the diagnosis. And other possible diagnoses should be excluded. And this is very important. And Dr. Kawasaki is a very incisive clinician. And he recognized that there are many other illnesses in pediatrics, most of which are infectious diseases, that can look fulfill the diagnostic criteria, and these include scarlet fever, include toxic shock syndrome, can include measles, as we're seeing now. So you have to consider other diagnoses to make the to be sure that it's Kawasaki disease. The problem with these criteria were that up to 20% of kids would not have fever and four of five other criteria. They would have maybe three, maybe two, maybe one, and there have been rare cases there where there has been no mucocutaneous findings or adenopathy. So there was a search for a way to be more inclusive in the diagnosis, and this I think was fulfilled in 2004 with the publication of, in a simultaneous publication in Circulation and Pediatrics, of a new diagnostic approach, which include an algorithm, which was the first time where laboratory tests results were included in the differential diagnosis, as well as echocardiographic findings over and above aneurysms. And if a child presented with fever for 5 days and two or three or even fewer of the other criteria, you would do laboratory tests, which would include a CBC looking for a low hemoglobin, white cell count of over 15,000, platelet count of over 450,000 or whatever the upper limit of normal is in your lab, after 7 days of illness, because this is a phenomenon that occurs late in the course, not early in the course. So if you look at it in day five or even day seven, you won't see it yet. It appears around day 10, peaks at about day 21. High ALT, and finally, 10 white cells per high-powered field in urine. Now, it's important, if you're trying to rule out Kawasaki disease, to do a bagged urine specimen. The white cells are from a urethritis, so if you do a cast specimen, you may miss it. So it's important to do a bag specimen. Well, this algorithm was put together by a group of very knowledgeable folks, Jane Neuberger at Boston. Mike Takahashi was the second author on this. Very experienced people. But it wasn't, and it was based on what was perceived as the major laboratory echocardiographic findings, but it was not subject to a randomized controlled trial. So in an effort to validate this algorithm as a useful diagnostic tool, what was done was the Kawasaki Research Group, which we were a part of, which we were a part, used patients who had been included in the IVIG trials, the steroid trials, children who were known to have Kawasaki disease based on the best diagnostic methods available at the time. And then analyzed their findings And they selected children from this study who had Z-scores of their coronary arteries greater than 3, meaning that was more than just mild coronary artery dilatation. So we were fairly certain, 99.99% certain, that these children did have Kawasaki disease. Very important. So it's not, it's retrospective, but it was based on patients who were, as carefully as we could select, were known to have Kawasaki disease. We found 195 patients, 137 or 70% of which met the case definition and would have been and were treated based on a full, not incomplete Kawasaki presentation. However, 27% or 53 were incomplete and therefore were they were run through the algorithm, and they found that every one of those cases would have been picked up by the algorithm. So we feel very confident that the algorithm that is suggested will pick up the vast majority of kids. The 5 kids who weren't picked up were seen too early and didn't have 5 days of fever or 1 or 2 of the other things, and so persistent follow-up would have identified them. Epidemiology of Kawasaki disease. In the United States, the incidence rate of Kawasaki disease appears pretty stable over the last 10 or 15 years. And as you may be able to see in this slide, the rate of Kawasaki has ranged between 15 and 20 patients per 100,000 children less than 5 years of age. About 85-90% of children who have Kawasaki disease are between 1 and 5 years of age. The bottom portion of this slide shows the regionality. The highest peak here represents the Northeast, where they see somewhat more. But the incidence of Kawasaki disease in the United States is fairly stable, about 4,000 or 5,000 cases a year. And as you can see here, the rate has varied between 18 and 20,000 patients per 100,000 children less than 5 years of age up to 2006, and I don't know of any data that suggests that it's gone up. In Japan, however, and other parts of Asia, a very different pattern has been seen. And this is the rate of the incidence rate in Japan, which has gone up steadily since it was first recognized in 1967. In addition, these 3 peaks represent nationwide epidemics of Kawasaki disease that occurred, which remain to be explained in terms of etiology, but it was a very dramatic, each epidemic, particularly the one in 1982, it was 1979, 82, and 86, where they had just dramatic numbers of cases which started in different localities in Japan and then spread out. They have a very active surveillance for Kawasaki disease, and they were able to show epicenters that then from which spread the illness in Japan. And you can see that Asian patients tend to be more likely to get Kawasaki disease than non-Asian patients. And the incidence rate in Japan as of 2008 was somewhat over 200 per 100,000 children less than 5 years of age, 10 times what we see in the United States. Korea is second, and interestingly enough, genetically, Koreans are closer to Japanese than any of the other Asian races. It's about half. Taiwan and China is about half that in Korea. The United States, as I mentioned, is about 18, 19 per 100,000. Hawaii, however, has a rate closer to that in China, because about 70-80% of the population of Hawaii has some Asian, particularly Japanese, genetic background. So this was one of the first things that made us think that genetics had a very strong role in the susceptibility of Kawasaki disease. Epidemiology and climate has also been appreciated as a real phenomenon. And this shows from pediatric infectious disease CDC data, where rainfall is associated with Kawasaki disease. Now, it has been known to be a winter-spring disease, except in tropical areas like Hawaii, where it tends to be year-round in its presentation. A number of studies, and we participated in one in San Diego, where we looked at our rainfall pattern and showed a very significant association between rain. This was a fascinating study, and I don't know what to make of this, but this was a study, Jane Burns down in San Diego, partnered with NOAA, the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, to get a finer idea of how environment and weather may influence Kawasaki disease. She subsequently also partnered with some epidemiologists and meteorologists in Spain, and they discovered an extremely interesting phenomenon. This is the incidence in Japan. Here are the three epidemics. And they noticed associated with each of the epidemics a rare phenomenon where the wind came from the northwest to the southeast. In other words, blew across Central Asia, particularly the Gobi Desert, across Asia and down across the Pacific to the United States. And the peak incidence for this rather unusual weather pattern was associated with each of the epidemics. They subsequently looked at the incidence of Japan and these tropospheric wind patterns, as well as surface wind patterns. And this was a surface wind pattern here. The top is Japan, the middle is San Diego, and the bottom is Hawaii. And they noticed the red marks, the red lines are the incidence of Kawasaki disease, and the blue lines are the unusual tropospheric and surface wind patterns, very closely related. We still have no idea what the implication of this might be. There is no known human pathogen that can be distributed in this way, but if you're an infectious disease person, you know that when we get a lot of wind in California, as we had in the late 80s, early 90s, there was a tremendous epidemic of coccidioidomycosis. So it is plausible. Possible etiologies of Kawasaki disease, because it shares so many clinical symptoms and signs with infectious agents, it was natural to think it might be an infection. And this is just a number of the different viruses and bacteria that have been associated with Kawasaki disease over the years. Unfortunately, none of them have proven to be a cause. The staph or strep toxin idea we'll talk about in a minute, and an unknown RNA virus is the focus of pretty intense investigation now. In the late 80s and early 90s, Don Leung and Jun Abbey from Japan noticed that the T cell receptor families in peripheral blood of Kawasaki patients showed a marked expansion of V beta 2 and V beta 8 families of T cells. And this suggests a polyclonal immune response, as can be elicited by superantigens. TSST1 is a bacteria, the TSST1 toxin is a superantigen. Streptococcal pyrogenic exotoxins are also superantigens, and this Kawasaki appeared to behave very similarly to these illnesses. And I must say, toxic shock syndrome can look very, very much like Kawasaki disease. So we set out on an investigation to see if children with Kawasaki disease had a disproportionate colonization or isolation of TSST1 producing bacteria. And we were one of the hospitals participating in this. And although, and we had febrile control patients, although we came close, there was not a statistically significant difference. However, and never do this, in post-hoc analysis, this was not a analysis that we set out to do, but if we took away one of the superantigens that we tested for, the staphylococcal enterotoxin antigen, it became statistically significant. Well, we thought we were on to something, but as it turns out, nobody else has been able to replicate this data. However, folks at Chicago Children's Hospital, Chicago Memorial Hospital in Chicago, set out on some very interesting pathologic and molecular studies back in the late 90s and 2000s. And the first observation was in the tissue, particularly the cardiac tissue and other tissues in children who had died of Kawasaki disease, they found a proliferation of macrophages and CD8 lymphocytes. Further studies showed that when they sequenced the genes from the tissue, they found what appeared to be not a polyclonal immune response, but an oligoclonal or a conventional antigen-driven immune response. So they took the genes and synthesized antibodies based on what the genetic code was, and then subjected tissue to a number of these potential possible serologic responses, and they found one synthetic antibody stained rather dramatically the ciliary epithelium of the lungs and respiratory tree in Kawasaki disease, and not in control patients or the other potential putative serologies. Then they looked at coronary artery tissue and again saw the evidence of staining using the synthetic antibody, both in the cardiac tissue, prostatic ducts, also involves inflammation in the prostate, the pancreas, and other organs, and also stained for anti-CD8 or macrophages, and showed in the myocardium and the arteries rather dramatic staining for macrophages. So they felt they were onto something. They continued their studies. And this was published not too many years ago, showing in this picture amphiphilic intracytoplasmic inclusions in the ciliated epithelium, which they then stained with the antibody, the serum, and it showed staining at the sites. They also stained using a methyl green pyrinin stain, which indicates presence of RNA, and also stained the antigen positive macrophages in the myocardium. So this suggested to them that this could be associated with viral infection. It was associated with the serum that they had developed, and it was located in the same places in these patients. They also did electron microscopy and showed ciliated bronchial epithelium with electron dense apical intracytoplasmic inclusions, very virally looking, as well as alveolar macrophages with spheroid bodies. Unfortunately, in the pathologic material that they had available, there were about 40 or so patients who had died or had heart transplants, which provided them the explanted heart to study. They were all paraffinized. And so they could not show ultrastructure changes indicating virus in this case. Parenthetical statement, if you happen to have a patient here at UCLA or at Cedars where a biopsy of a lymph node or any other tissue has been done for any reason, try and have it fixed in glutaraldehyde or frozen at minus 70 and get on the phone with Ann Rowley, who is undertaking these tests. This is the holy grail. If we can get a piece of pathologic tissue like that, we may be able to actually identify the etiologic agent more specifically in Kawasaki. And these are cytoplasmic inclusions in bronchial epithelium that they showed by immunofluorescence. So there's strong evidence now that suggests that a virus may be involved in this disease. And the feeling is that the virus or pathogen, if you will, is a trigger in a immunologically susceptible patient that leads to the clinical syndrome that we see as Kawasaki disease. When a child is infected, the respiratory tree is infected, activates macrophages and lymphocytes, T8 lymphocytes, which enter the circulation, and in, again, genetically susceptible individuals who are at risk for coronary artery disease, macrophages can cause inflammation in the vessel, weakening the vessel, and leading to aneurysm formation. Can we think of a virus that behaves in this way? Kawasaki disease is almost exclusively in children. It requires a susceptible, genetically susceptible host. And a good example could be human herpes virus 6 and roseola. It is a ubiquitous virus. It affects all children before the age of 2 or so. Only a tiny fraction of those patients actually get roseola, maybe suggesting a genetically susceptible underpinning. And so this is probably the best thought about Kawasaki disease right now. In terms of pathology, we really thought we understood the pathology pretty well. Kawasaki, as you know, is felt to be a self-limited vasculitis in children. This was based on pathologic studies done primarily in Japan in straddling the pre-gamma globulin and post-gamma globulin eras. And it was understood to be a coronary arteritis with edematous dissociation of the tunica media. Started both from the endothelium and the adventitia and caused a panarteritis. There were lymphocytes and macrophages, a lot of neutrophilic infiltration in the arterial wall, weakening it, resulting in inflammation and potentially thrombosis and or rupture and granulomatous inflammation. By day 25, the inflammation tends to go subside, and by day 40, there was no inflammation left at all. That's how we understood it. We were cool. It was fine. Until Dr. Ornstein, who's a pathologist at Chicago Memorial, and his colleagues published a paper suggesting another interpretation of the pathologic findings might be appropriate. And this is in now a molecular analysis, not just light microscopy analysis of the disease. They identified three stages: necrotizing arteritis, which is a synchronized acute self-limited inflammatory process. Synchronized means you have inflammation in the heart and you have a clinical syndrome at the same time. Very easy. And it was not substantially different than what had been reported before, and this represented about 80% of patients with Kawasaki disease. However, they also noticed a subacute chronic vasculitis, an asynchronous process, meaning that they saw pathology in their analysis, but the children at this point were not sick at all. And there were no laboratory tests that could identify if there was ongoing inflammation. And then finally, luminal myofibroblastic proliferation, which was closely linked to the subacute chronic vasculitis, which led to proliferation of smooth muscle cells that were derived from myofibroblastic cells, no granulomatous inflammation, no apparent atherosclerosis, but in some percentage of Kawasaki patients, presumably a very small one, led to obstruction and thrombosis. This is the necrotizing vasculitis, and obviously very intense inflammation, polymorphonuclear leukocytes and macrophages in the artery of patients with Kawasaki disease. This is the subacute chronic vasculitis, mainly small lymphocytes and plasma cells, some eosinophils. They saw it as early as 2 weeks into the illness, but it could begin later. And it is very closely linked with the luminal myofibroblastic proliferation, very common for this process to lead to LMP. And this is what happens to a very, presumably a very small percentage of children with Kawasaki disease. This is the both the combined, the subacute chronic inflammation and this proliferation of smooth muscle cells derived from myofibroblasts that occlude the artery and potentially can cause either aneurysms or obstruction of the artery, stenosis of the artery, leading to the consequences of that. Well, this really has made the pathology, at least, of Kawasaki disease much more complicated. And we are now trying to figure out who are these kids who may have this? How do you identify it? Are there biomarkers that we can use to identify children with ongoing inflammation and or obstruction? How can we treat it? Is it treatable? Does it respond to the things we use, like IVIG and some other immune modulators? And how should we follow Kawasaki kids going forward? So again, more information, but more questions about what causes and the pathogenesis of Kawasaki disease. I'd just like to mention briefly IVIG non-response. Any of you who have treated enough Kawasaki kids know that a small percentage of kids, 13 to 15%, don't respond or don't definitively respond to IVIG. However, we had an experience in the early 2000s, which showed that the incidence of non-response went up to almost 30%, and it stayed up above the norm, which is in our hospital 14 to 17% up. We look for markers that were associated with this non-response rate. We found that albumin, lower albumin, was seen more commonly in the non-responders. Bands were higher, and they tended to have a more abnormal echo early on than kids who responded well to Kawasaki disease. The very next year, 2006, San Diego had a similar experience where almost 40% of their children did not respond to IVIG. And they similarly looked for markers for this and found that high band rate, high GGT, and a low hemoglobin were all associated more commonly with the failure to respond. We still don't understand why this happened. Both centers looked very carefully at what the type of IVIG where you're using for other factors that might be associated, and we were not able to find any. Neither of us have had similar rates since then. But I want to make one clinical plea here, and this is the importance of discharge instructions for Kawasaki disease. We now know that 13 to 30% of kids will either not respond at all or will relapse after IVIG. We looked at a series of 40 patients in our hospital who relapsed after getting a dose of IVIG. And 47% of those patients relapsed after they left the hospital. In other words, their fever went down, they looked a lot better, we sent them home, and their fever came back. You have to tell parents that if the fever comes back, call us. We need to reevaluate the patient. The consequences are seen here. This is a child, about a 2-year-old Hispanic girl, who presented with Kawasaki disease. We treated her, I think, twice, if I remember correctly. She got better. Her rash went away. Her fever went away. We sent her home. After we, with a translator, very carefully explained, if the fever comes back, call us. 10 days later, she came back to clinic. And we bring them back pretty early just because of this problem. And the day after discharge, her fever returned. She was miserable the whole time. She was sitting in bed. Hands were swollen, feet were swollen, eyes were red. And we did an echocardiogram. This is her right coronary artery. This is her aorta. Bilateral giant coronary artery aneurysm. I never want to experience this again. So you must very carefully explain to parents that if the fever recurs, you need to talk to them. So in response to this, we were wondering if there was any other better markers for retreatment. And we developed a kind of a convenient sample of 143 patients that were more or less consecutive. We had done some other studies and looked at these patients, and 116 of these had a very rapid response, no relapse, they did fine. However, 27 of these patients had either persistent or recurrent fever, and 15 of these patients had persistent fever and tachycardia, both together, diminished fever. 11 had diminished fever and persistent tachycardia, and one had persistent fever but resolved tachycardia. Why tachycardia? 100% of children with Kawasaki disease in the first week to 10 days have myocarditis. And I won't explain why that's true, but it's a well-known phenomenon. And in fact, children will occasionally come in shock because of the myocarditis that they have. So we were thinking, if myocarditis is a part and parcel of the disease, maybe we should be more acutely looking for that. And if you encounter a patient who is sleeping, who is not irritable, and their heart rate is still 160, there's something wrong there. This is a child who was a complicated kid, but she had been treated in another hospital, was referred to us for an angiogram because they were worried about her. And she had been treated already with IVIG and also gotten methylprednisolone in our hospital. She became afebrile, she spiked again, she got infliximab, her fever went down, but her heart rate remained somewhat high. We realized this in retrospect. So she went home, her fever returned, we gave her IVIG again, didn't respond, we gave her infliximab again, and eventually her fever went down, and eventually her heart rate went down. And we have other examples where the heart rate went down, did not go down when the fever did go down. And we noticed that of the 27 patients who had persistent or recurrent fever, 6 were discharged home when their fever normalized, but they remained tachycardic. 140, 150, 160 beats per minute. And 5 out of the 6 were still tachycardic at the time of discharge. So because resting tachycardia is well appreciated as a part and parcel of the disease, it should be viewed as an indicator of myocardial inflammation. And this is a small, convenient sample. We're continuing to evaluate this. But if you have a child who is maybe still a little irritable and still tachycardic, be very, very cautious about discharging. And if you do, warn the parents that fever may come back, and they should be aware of that. There are other immune modulators that have been used. The most common is infliximab or Remicade. The first case was tried in a 3-year-old who had failed IVIG, I think, 3 times. We then participated in a trial that Jane Burns put together, 17 patients who failed standard treatment. They all responded to infliximab. She then did a pilot randomized controlled trial and showed it was not inferior. And she has just published the results of a prospective randomized placebo-controlled trial of infliximab intensification. In other words, they compared IVIG, aspirin, and infliximab with IVIG and aspirin plus placebo as primary therapy. The primary outcome was treatment resistance, which was defined as persistent or recurrent fever of 38 degrees between 36 hours and 7 days after the end of IVIG therapy. They also looked at Z-scores and the proximal LAD and proximal right coronary artery. Unfortunately, resistance rate was the same in both groups. So infliximab doesn't seem to be more effective, at least in terms of the prevention of fever in Kawasaki patients. When they looked at the secondary outcomes, in the proximal LAD, there was a significantly better improvement in the p-value of the z-scores of the LAD, but that went away by 5 weeks of age. And when they looked at the right coronary artery, there was really no difference. But clearly, these patients who got infliximab became, the acute phase reactants went down much more rapidly. So it does have a mitigating effect, at least on the inflammation, but not on the coronary artery problem. There is another study which is ongoing at Seattle Children's using etanercept, which is another TNF inhibitor. So, and that is about 80% completed. I think they have 80% of their goal. So we'll see if etanercept may have any benefit. There are many papers presented at the meeting that we attended. very prominent among these were a number of studies looking at genetic susceptibility to Kawasaki disease. Particularly ITPKC, Cas3, and other genes appear to be associated with the susceptibility of getting Kawasaki disease. Interestingly, many of these have links to autoimmune diseases, and gene expression suggests a activation of an innate immunity and complement pathways, not a polyclonal response. Also, looking at gene products, suggesting susceptibility to non-responsiveness to IVIG and to coronary artery outcomes. Clearly, in the pre-gamma globulin era, only about 20 to 25% of kids got coronary artery abnormalities. So there is something about a fifth of the children, a quarter to the fifth, that if you get Kawasaki disease, you will probably get coronary artery involvement. And these were some of those. If you take nothing away from this talk, realize that Kawasaki disease is the most common cause of acquired heart disease in children in the developed world. It's a more common cause of coronary artery involvement and cardiac involvement than viral myocarditis, rheumatic fever, or endocarditis and native heart valves combined. So this is not a common disease, but it is a very important disease in terms of children. There are many cardiovascular findings, as we have talked about, tachycardia due to myocarditis, left ventricular dilatation, and coronary artery dilatation, either very mild or more severe, in 30 to 50% of kids starting around day 9 or 10. The worst possible scenario is the development of giant coronary artery aneurysms greater than 8 millimeters. And here you can see the left atrium, right ventricle. This is the left coronary artery, in this patient, which again approximates the size of his aorta. And this is on the angiogram, which shows a huge aneurysm. Two things happen here which set up the possibility of thrombosis. One, the pulse flow of blood in the aneurysm is very slow, which allows for clot formation, and it's much more turbulent. So giant coronary artery aneurysms are extremely dangerous and will eventually lead to death if not proper anticoagulation is given. This is a study that Dr. Kato published that, again, saddled the pre- and post-gamma globulin era. This was published in Circulation in 1996. It remains the largest single study looking at long-term outcome. They had almost 600 Kawasaki patients. About 75% of them had normal coronary arteries. About 25% developed coronary artery abnormalities. Almost half by 2 months had regressed back to normal looking. About 60 or about 10% had persistent enlargement of coronary arteries. And 14 of these 60 went on to develop stenosis. And here we see on a CT scan, which is sort of replaced infusion and catheterization to demonstrate aneurysms. This shows a huge giant coronary artery aneurysm of the left anterior descending with subsequent stenosis developing there. This is the worst case scenario. This is a 3 month old girl, very early on in our experience, who was 3 weeks into the illness, had a cardiac arrest, died on autopsy. This is the left main coronary artery, a huge coronary artery, and this is the left anterior descending coronary artery, totally filled with clot. The mortality rate in Japan early on was about 3%. Now it's way less than 1%. Our mortality rate was about 1%. Now it's way less than that. Our last fatality, I talked to Mike about this a couple of weeks ago, and was 16 years ago. And we have had giant coronary arteries since. These are risk factors for development of coronary artery abnormalities, particularly if treatment is delayed, and particularly infants less than 1 year of age are much more susceptible. The youngest child I have seen develop Kawasaki disease was 2 weeks of age at the time of onset of illness, and that child had huge and still does have huge coronary arteries. He's now pushing 30, and he's still on warfarin and still on aspirin, but doing okay. And males are much more common than females. We would love to have a biomarker that can, since we don't know the etiology, that can tell us with some more security that this is Kawasaki disease. And there have been a number of potential biomarkers identified now through proteomics, and hopefully these will prove to be not only valuable in making the diagnosis, but predicting which children are going to have coronary artery abnormalities. In terms of a study done in the United States, this again was just published from Northern California Kaiser Permanente, where they identified 546 Kawasaki patients seen over about a 20-year period. They looked at, they picked up patients who were at least 15 years of age because they were looking for long-term outcomes, and most of these patients were less than 5 years of age at diagnosis. About 80% were treated with IVIG. And this is how they got to the 546 patients. 59 had not been followed for a year. So these were the outcomes. Again, 80%, no lesions. Transient ectasia, mild dilatation that didn't last long, about 3.5%. Transient aneurysm and about 4%, and about 5% had a persistent aneurysm, not too different from the study by Kato, and about 40 patients, they did not have diagnosis. There were events involving a larger number of these patients, and note that many of these kids were very young, 2, 5, 13, but the actual event accruing to them because of the coronary artery disease happened years or decades later. And this is a very important observation. Several deaths, acute deaths, not always explained by what they found on autopsy. This is how some of these giant coronary arteries will progress. This is a 13-month-old boy. The first coronary artery angiography showed a giant coronary artery aneurysm, some stenosis at the distal end. 2 years later, had another angiography. He also had a moderately size saccular aneurysm on the right, more severe stenosis of the left anterior descending, and 11 years of illness, the right coronary artery is still patent, but still with aneurysms, and the left coronary artery was totally thrombosed. This child was asymptomatic. This is our experience, and I think I'll end here because and answer questions for you. This is a child who had a large coronary artery aneurysm acutely, and 2 years later was totally remodeled. That does not mean that these are normal aneurysms, normal arteries. This is an intravascular ultrasound which shows severe scarring and even calcium formation. And I'll stop here, answer any questions. I had some other slides about management of these, cardiac management of these, but I'm an infectious disease doctor. What do I know? So thank you very much.